Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
So Janet Yellen, the head of the Federal Reserve, who has given tens of trillions of dollars to private banking families, they've got Bernie Sanders, the socialist, targeting the Walmart family, which has made most of their wealth with Chinese slave goods and with undercutting markets and with telling their employees to go get on welfare. So, I mean, they're not free market. Very predatory. A product of NAFTA. Yeah, they've got $140 billion between about seven people. Like one of them's worth like 60 billion smackers. And when they're not out, you know, dying in ultralight crashes, you know, they're busy manipulating our lives, funding both parties. You got the Koch brothers that funded Bill Clinton and the Republicans. But those are the classic boogeymen. It's not that I'm saying they're good. It's just that that's all you ever hear about. What about the Rockefellers? What about the Rothschilds that control trillions? But she says, oh, I'm very concerned about the inequality. And I can't say if we're an oligarchy or not. As if she isn't at the top of the pyramid of the managerial system that's doing all this. And they're passing things to raise taxes on people making $100,000, $200,000, $300,000 a year, telling poor people that's a rich person to extinct the middle class that's the ladder up to wealth, which is the classic political action of any authoritarian regime. They're going to use the inequality they've created to fully gut capitalism. What they've set up is a capitalism. And her and Sanders are up there playing the status game and the class envy game. Hey, you go to countries that are socialist, they're totally poor and hellish, folks. Or people are lazy and aimless, like France. And it's all collapsing into eugenics. It's a plan. Socialism is a tool of fascism. National socialists were really fascist. They teach socialism and fascism two different things. No, they're not. It's all different flavors of cyanide-laced Kool-Aid. Let's go back to her amazing response to Sanders. And we are an oligarchy, and they are setting up a police state. And they're going to manage everybody and forcibly take the wealth because it's a tool of control. And they're going to give it short-term to the welfare class. Because they're the big corporate whore welfare class that want to secure their ill-gotten gains, and they're going to use poverty and 2 plus 2 equals 5 dumbed-down population to get it done. Let's go to the clip.
So all of the statistics on inequality that you've cited are ones that greatly concern me, and I think for the same reason that you're concerned about them, they can shape the, determine the ability of different groups to participate equally in a democracy and have grave effects on social stability over time. And so I don't know what to call our system or how to, I prefer not to give labels, but there's no question that we've had a trend toward growing inequality, and I personally find it a very worrisome trend that deserves the attention of policymakers.
Thank you. I mean, I think the point that the professors are making and others have made is that there comes a point where the billionaire class has so much political power, where the Koch brothers are now, because of Citizens United, able to buy and sell politicians. They have so much political power. At what point is that reversible? And that is a great concern to me.
So there you go. Full clip up on Infowars.com with CNSNews.com that first grabbed that clip. So good job on that. We're going to come back. We're going to get Bruce Fein on, constitutional lawyer, the man who killed the Fairness Doctrine more than anybody. He brought forward as the deputy commissioner of the FCC. And we've got the new head of the FCC saying that this is all basically a takeover that's happening. It's only one small part of the attack on free speech. How do we defend against this? Straight ahead with Bruce Fein. I'm Alex Jones of Infowars.com. And don't forget the nightly news, 7 o'clock weeknights. And I'll be back this Sunday as well, live, 4 to 6 p.m. Stay with us, ladies and gentlemen. We're the hardest working folks in media because we know it's about the fight for liberty. Bruce Fein doesn't toot his horn, but we need to understand that, A, you can be effective, you can change things, because we have justice and free speech on our side. The moral high ground was back in the 80s as the General Counsel of the Federal Communications Commission under President Ronald Reagan and the Deputy Attorney General, Associate Deputy Attorney General, as well, he was able to craft the First Amendment case and get Congress and the government to get rid of the Fairness Doctrine that was properly Orwellianly named, like the Patriot Act and so many other things, or the Affordable Care Act that increases the cost of health care and wrecks it. It's the opposite of that. But again, this is the age of 1984, where Obama says that the Ukrainian government is duly elected. That's like saying Kim Jong-un is duly elected, or you can raise the debt ceiling and it doesn't raise the debt, or you have a business, you didn't build that. Or the Benghazi documents that came out last week aren't about Benghazi. I mean, this is the 1984 world, but no one's watching MSNBC. Their normal shows have 100,000, top show half a million. That's nothing. We have more than that every 30 minutes here. 3 million a day. And we're not even in the top five talk show hosts. We're in the top 10. So understand, they're not going to let us continue to operate with a free open internet. They're coming in with net neutrality killers. They're coming in with this new office that got scrapped earlier this year but brought back to go inspect all media to see if it's racist. That's out of the White House. You got the FCC being, I guess, told by Obama and moving in the direction to apply SEC finance rules. And the head of the, and then we're going to our guest, the head of the FCC rightfully came out and said, I'm really concerned about what's being called for here. So we're not saying they're all bad. It's different people. It's like Bruce Fein was in the FCC, and he was a good guy. He's saying, look, this will affect Drudge and other libertarian or conservative media. They're going to apply it. And that's what they've been calling for, is not, you know, if I'm pro-gun, they'll say, well, that's a Republican policy, so you can't have your radio show. We're going to shut you up. Well, that's asinine. But before 1987, when Bruce Fein got rid of it, I couldn't have this show. So they're trying to bring us back to the past and a new electronic Berlin Wall or Dark Age, Iron Curtain. Bruce, constitutional lawyer, thank you for joining us today. As you're talking, I'm going to be showing a whole stack of news dealing with this, but there's so many attacks, but even mainstream news is saying this is about oligarchs in old media wanting to shut down their competition. But I think it's too late. I mean, even if they shut us down or try, they're already been so discredited by saying 2 + 2 = 5 that I don't think you can put Humpty Dumpty back together again. What do you say, sir?
No, I think that's true. And I feel compelled to just interject this with your recitation of all the Orwellian statements by President Obama, because you omitted one that was dear to my heart since I was born in Cambridge, Massachusetts, where Paul Revere's ride emanated. You know, listen, my children, and you shall hear of the midnight ride of Paul Revere. And you may recall in his speech where he announced sort of some cosmetic diminishing of the NSA's surveillance of all Americans, he attempted to liken Paul Revere as the precursor of the National Security Agency.
Oh, he said that. He said, yeah.
He said, wow, you talk about Orwellian. He didn't understand that Paul Revere was spying on the British as a citizen and was alerting the people to the government danger. He wasn't the government spying on the citizens. But that sort of is the high watermark of the Obama dissimulation about reality. But let's go back to the, you know, the issue that you'd raised, Alex, about the Fairness Doctrine and trying to get the government to police the communications elements of our democratic dispensation. Now, I was able to get the FCC to revoke the Fairness Doctrine. It wasn't the Congress did it. We did it on our own because it basically chilled the expression of any speech that's viewed as controversial. And basically, speech that's worth having is controversial. You know, you don't need speech to utter bromides. And after we had revoked it, there were efforts in the Congress, in fact, to reinstate it that President Reagan vetoed, and the veto was upheld.
Sure, just to be clear, I was going back to just, you know, vague memories of the research of that, that I knew there were some hearings against it that you, I think, were part of, and then later they tried to bring it back. The point is that battle's been going on for a while.
Yes, that's true. And then they had what was called the Flush the Rush campaign, where their women's groups were trying to reinstate, reinstate the fairness doctrine.
Outrageous.
In order to drive conservative talk radio off of the airwaves. And what's being flirted with now, the Federal Election Commission, is to remove what is now, I think, a First Amendment compelled exemption from financial disclosure, financial expenditure laws, and political campaigns, so that right now, for instance, if you're the New York Times, you can editorialize in favor against particular candidates. You can slant your reporting in favor against it. It can be worth tens of thousands, if not millions of dollars, and you don't have to report that as a contribution. You know, it's not limited by any ceiling. There's no particular obligation to explain how the money was used to write the editorial or whatever. And that those First Amendment exemptions that are thought implicit in the finance campaign laws now are thought, well, really, should we keep those exemptions for Drudge Report or from Hannity or maybe even persons like you, Alex, if you're being too pointed in favoring one candidate or